Chapter 2, Everblaze. Calm down, we'll figure this out. Keith promised as Sophie clutched her head and groaned from the migraine. Are you doing anything different? She took a slow, deep breath and tried to think through her panic. No, I can picture exactly where we need to go. But it's like my mind hits a wall when it tried to take us there. Have you tried taking us somewhere else? Keith asked. Maybe there's some sort of security around the sanctuary to keep teleporters away. Sophie doubted that since she was the only elf who could teleport, but it was worth a try. She just couldn't think of anywhere else to go. Her mind was racing a million directions and they all ended in a blank. How about home? Keith asked. Can you take us home? An image flashed in Sophie's mind, so sharp and clear it made her eyes water. Or maybe the tears were for the narrow crack that finally split through the darkness. She had just enough time to tighten her grip on Kif's hand, then the air filled with the boom of thunder as they blasted out of the void. They hit the ground hard, tumbling across lushy grass before landing in a heap. Sophie sat up first, untangling herself from Kif's arms as she stared at the gray, overcast sky. This isn't Havenfield, Keith said, squinting at the narrow street lined with plain square houses. I know. Sophie rallied her concentration, imagining an invisible barrier wrapping around her head to shield herself from the voices pummeling her brain. She'd forgotten how loud human thoughts could be. This is San Diego. Keith scrambled to his feet. You teleported us to a forbidden city? Okay, that is awesome. Don't get me wrong, I could do without the whole almost getting trapped in the endless black nothingness thing. But this is epic! I mean, that's a human! He pointed across the street to a mom in a bright blue tracksuit, jogging with her baby in a stroller. Yeah, and she can probably hear us, Sophie whispered. Surely everyone must have noticed the teenagers in strange clothes who fell out of the sky. But the few people outside weren't even glancing their way, too busy walking their dogs or checking their mail. I don't think they know we're here, Kif said, pointing to a small black orb nestled in an overgrown daisy bush. There was another next to the trunk of the giant sycamore in the center of the yard, and three more along the path. Obscurers. Sophie had only seen the light and sound bending gadgets once before in the hands of her kidnappers when they ambushed her and Dex on a bridge in Paris. One of them was the same blonde elf who tried to snatch her months earlier, posing as a human jogger on the very street she was standing on. She walked to the spot where she'd face him, hoping it might help her remember something new. But all she could see was his face, and Alden had already entered his image in the council's database, which was supposed to have a record of every elf ever born. No match had been found. He was a ghost, only real when he jumped out of the shadows like the rest of the rebels in their dark hooded cloaks, with a creepy eye in a white circle sewn under the sleeve. Maybe we should go, Sophie said, glancing over her shoulder, half expecting to spot the rebels jogging toward them. Are you kidding? I've been dying to see where the mysterious Miss Foster grew up. Kif turned toward her weathered old house. It's small. Compared to the crystal mansions of her new world, it was practically a hovel. But humans weren't given a bird fund like elves were. They didn't get to start their lives with more money than they could ever possibly need. It smells weird too, Kif decided. What is that? Smog, I think. She'd forgotten how sour human air tasted. It made her not want to breathe. And the spots of oil staining the street and bits of litter in the gutters made her almost embarrassed to admit she used to live there. And yet, it was the first place she'd thought of when Kif had said, home. A lump caught in her throat as she made her way to the front door. Of course, it was locked, and the shutters on the windows were closed tight. But one had a crooked blind, and when Sophie peeked through, she could see that the house had been gutted right down to the concrete slab and the insulation in the walls. She shouldn't have been surprised. She knew her family had been relocated, and she'd already seen where the elves had stored all her old things in an unmarked building in Mysterium, one of the smaller elven cities. But staring at the empty shell of her old life made it seem like all her memories had just been a dream. There was nothing left to prove any of it had been real. Unless. She rushed to the top step of the path, dropping to her knees where her dad's messy writing was still etched into the concrete. WDFEIFSEFARF. She traced her fingers over her initials. They didn't erase me. Kif squinted at the sloppy letters. Does that say elf? No. That's an I, Emma Iris Foster, My dad was William David Foster, and my sister was Amy Rose Foster. I don't think my parents realized their initials spelled ARF until it was too late. Not that it matters anymore. Now they were Connor, Kate, and Natalie Freeman. Sophie wasn't supposed to know their new names, but the Black Swan had given them to her, and she'd been careful not to let anyone know she knew. So this is where Fitz found you? Kif asked. I always wondered where he was disappearing to on his classified assignments, and I would have found a way to follow him if I'd known he was off chasing girls. He wasn't chasing me, Sophie said, feeling her face hit up. Well, he did have to chase me the first time we met, but he was freaking me out. Fitz is pretty terrifying. Hey, when you've been hiding a secret ability for 7 years and a total stranger outs you in the middle of a museum, you run, no matter how cute he is. She wanted to clamp her hands over her mouth as soon as the words left her lips, but that only would have made it worse. All she could do was turn bright red and wait for Kif to tease her. He cleared his throat. What about the other boy, the one who disappeared? Was that here? I think so. Part of her hated that Kif knew her secrets, most of them anyway. But she'd had to tell him when they were working together to save Alden, and Kif would never let her forget it. Not that she could remember much about the mysterious disappearing boy. She knew he had to be important because she had a blurry memory of him vanishing from when she was 5 years before Fitz found her and showed her she was an elf. And she could remember him wearing a blue bramble jersey, a game only elves played. It was also right around the time Mr. Forkle triggered her telepathy, so there had to be a connection. But the Black Swan had torn the pages out of her journal and wiped the memory out of her mind, save for the few vague details she'd managed to recover. He stood right here, she said, moving closer to the sycamore and running her fingers along a branch. He must have been taller than she'd realized, not really a boy at all, more like a teenager. And there was something else, a detail so close she could feel it prickling her consciousness. But no matter how hard she concentrated, she couldn't reach it. Hey, no need to punish the innocent plant life, Kif said as she kicked the tree. I'm sure the Black Swan will tell you everything soon. Sophie wished she could believe him. She thought the Black Swan would be working with her now, especially since she'd risk her life to let them heal her abilities. But 2 weeks had passed since she'd fled their hideout during the rebels' attack, and she hadn't heard a peep. Not a note, not a clue, not even the slightest sign that they were still watching her. She turned to the pale blue house next door where Mr. Forkle used to sit every day, looking bloated and wrinkled in his struckleberry-induced disguise. He spent 12 years sitting in the middle of his lawn, playing with his silly gnomes, so he could keep an eye on her. Now all that was left were a few weathered figures picking through the weeds with their tiny ugly faces. What are those supposed to be? Kif asked as he followed her over the planter. Garden gnomes. You've got to be kidding me. You should see what humans think elves look like. They give us bells on our shoes and pointy ears, though I guess they're right about the ears. Sophie still wasn't thrilled that her ears would grow points as she aged, but at least she wouldn't have to worry about it for a few thousand years, thanks to the elves' indefinite lifespan. Kif laughed as he squatted to get a closer look at the tiny statues with pointy hats. Okay, I have to take one of this home. My agriculture mentor will pee his pants. Wait, Sophie said, as Kif reached for a gnome that was sitting on a rainbow-colored mushroom. What if it's the clue? There was no rhyme or reason to the way the gnomes lined up, but something felt familiar about their arrangement. She let her eyes go out of focus, and as the shadows blended into a dark swirl, the memory slowly surfaced. Cygnus! What's a Cygnus? Kif asked as she dropped to her knees and started to dig in the planter. A constellation. Each gnome is one of the stars. We call them Quella, Fushere, Rosine, Grisena, Saphaline, Scarlatina, Nievlo, Gilder, and Pisir. But humans call them Cygnus. Okay, miss, I've memorized all the stars. No need to show off. And I still don't see why you're borrowing like a dwarf. Because Cygnus means one, Sophie explained as she scooped out another handful of dirt. And the constellation is made up of 10 stars, but there are only 9 gnomes, so I'm checking where the 10th star would be. Slimy mud squished under her nails, but Sophie kept digging. After another minute, her fingertips brushed something cold and smooth. It's a bottle, Kif said as she unearthed a tiny green vial and wiped the crystal clean on the grass. and a note, Sophie added, removing the stopper and tipping the bottle until a curl of paper slid free. Kif snatched the note before she could touch it. Someone not covered in swamp sludge should reach that. He had a point. She wiped her hands on the grass as Kif frowned at the note. What? She asked. You're not going to like it. I usually don't. The black swan could be annoyingly vague with their clues, but she was happy to have them back in touch. Or she was until Kif showed her the message. Wait for instructions and stick to the plan. They could have at least made it rhyme again, he said, stuffing the note back into the bottle. And what plan? Sophie took the bottle and sniffled the nozzle, gagging at the familiar salty smell. It was the same green bottle she'd drunk an entire ounce of Limbium from and almost died in the process, thanks to her allergy, so she'd be able to heal minds again. Prentice is the plan, she told Kif, rubbing the star-shaped scar on the back of her hand. Mr. Forkel had injected her with tweaked human medicine to stop the allergic reaction, and the needle wound had never gone away. They're telling me to wait until they decide it's time to heal him. Yeah, well, I still think they could have rhymed. Wait for instructions and stick to the plan. Now get home safe as fast as you can. Sophie was too disappointed to laugh. She definitely wanted to heal Prentice, but she didn't want to wait. Prentice had been a keeper for the Black Swan, and 13 years ago, he'd let his mind get broken in a memory break to keep Sophie's existence secret from the rest of the elves. She hated knowing he was locked in a tiny cell in exile, moaning and drooling and waiting for her to pull him out of the darkness. Plus, every day that passed increased the chance that Alden would shatter again. His guilt over his role in Prentice's memory break had already broken his mind once, and even though Sophie had healed him, the only way to ensure his safety would be to bring Prentice back. Wait, there. But the counselors were still deciding if they were going to allow Prentice to be healed, and apparently the Black Swan were content to sit back and wait. Hey, how did they even know we'd come here? Kif asked as Sophie shoved the bottle into her pocket a little harder than she needed to. I mean, they've pulled off some crazy things, but I doubt even they could guess you'd have trouble teleporting and accidentally bring us to your old house instead of your new one. No, Sophie agreed, hating that the only new note the Black Swan had given her probably wasn't new at all. I must have just assumed I'd come here eventually. Still, she had a more pressing problem to deal with than the Black Swan being stubborn again. Neither she nor Kif were old enough to have their own pathfinders, so they'd have to get to a leap master, a gadget made of leaping crystals, in order to leap to the sanctuary. Do you have your home crystal with you? She asked Kif. Yeah, why? It's not safe to teleport until I figure out what went wrong. It's also not like there's a cliff to jump off, and if we go back to Havenfield, Sander will never let us leave. Especially now that we can only leap outside the sanctuary gates and wait to be left in. Kif stared at his feet, looking about as unexcited by this idea as Sophie felt. His father definitely belonged on her list of people she liked to avoid. Sylvany needs us, she said, reminding herself as much as him. I know, but what? She asked when he didn't finish. I don't bring friends home. He fidgeted with the pin clasping his cape, then the Sensen family crest. Two jeweled hands holding a candle with an emerald flame. His father had only given it to him a few weeks ago, even though most kids wore their family crest their whole lives. Okay, Sophie said slowly. I guess we'll go back to Havenfield then. If we run straight to the Leapmaster, we might be able to get us out of there before Sander can stop us. No, we won't. Probably not. Sander's goblin super senses would detect them the second they arrived. It's still worth a try. She dug out her home crystal, a pendant with a single facet, and held it up to the light. Kif glared at the beam, refracting toward the ground. This is stupid. He pulled out his own home crystal and created another light path. Sophie didn't have to be an empath to feel the tension in his grip or the way his fingers shook as they laced together with hers. Her hands were shaking too. But neither of them said anything as they stepped into the light, then warm, feathery rush pulled them both away.